Macmillan Audio presents Doc Holliday by Matthew Braun. Read for you by William Dufris. Which tooth is it?
That's one on the bottom. Hurts like a bastard.
The burly teamster pointed to his lower left jaw. He was stretched out in the reclining dental chair, which was positioned in a spill of sunlight from the window. Holliday selected a steel probe from a tray on a nearby table and peered into the man's mouth. He gently tapped the suspect tooth with the probe.
Holy shit!
The teamster bellowed.
I felt that plumb down on my toes.
Small wonder, Holliday said, placing the probe on the tray. You have an abscessed molar, rather far along. The tooth has to come out.
You gonna pull it?
I see no alternative.
How bad's it gonna hurt?
Holliday silently remarked that large, rough men were often the most squeamish about such matters. There was something childlike about them when fear lanced the tough outer shell. No need to alarm yourself overly much. We'll have it out in no time.
Hope to Christ you know your business.
Would you prefer to consult another dentist?
Nah, hell, I'm already here. Just go easy on me.
Holliday took a pair of extractor pliers from the tray. He nodded with a reassuring smile. Open wide, please. The teamster stared at the extractor with a look of wide-eyed fright. Holliday clasped his lower jaw in one hand and inserted the pliers into his yawning mouth. He gripped the tooth in the pincers, applying pressure, and gave it a forceful tug. When he met resistance, he strained harder, rocking the tooth back and forth. The teamster stiffened with a strangled moan. Holliday abruptly stepped back from the chair. His face flushed from the exertion, he was suddenly seized by a coughing spasm. He jerked a handkerchief from his pocket, wiping a wad of thick phlegm from his mouth. He wheezed harshly, took a slow, deep breath.
Jesus,
the teamster muttered.
Sounds like you need a sawbones yourself. You a lunger?
A slight cough, nothing more.
Holliday got hold of himself.
You've no need for concern. Shall we proceed?
Yeah, if you're sure. Good.
Holliday grabbed his jaw in a vice lock. He clamped onto the tooth, put one knee on the man's chest, and hauled upward with a mighty heave. The molar popped out in a mass of blood and rotted roots. The teamster groaned, holding his jaw tightly.
You like to tore my head off.
I have no doubt. You will recover.
Holliday dropped the tooth into a porcelain pan. As he returned the extractor to the tray, his features contorted and another coughing seizure shook his frame. He moved unsteadily to a cabinet, removed a quart of bourbon, and gulped a long dose. He corked the bottle, his color slowly returning to normal.
God damn.
The teamster rose from the chair, watching him.
You're sure enough a lunger, ain't you? Feller in your shape ought to be working on people.
How very perceptive of you,
Holliday commented.
I suggest you rinse your mouth with salt water 3 or 4 times a day. You owe me $2.
The teamster dug silver cartwheels from his pocket.
I still say you got a hell of a nerve. Last time you'll see me.
A loss of incalculable proportions. Good day to you, sir.
The teamster hesitated, vaguely aware that he'd been insulted. But then, looking deeper into Holliday's eyes, he saw something that stifled any reply. He walked out the door. Holliday scrubbed his hands in a pan of soapy water. As he toweled dry, he sourly reflected on this latest incident. A month had passed since he had opened the office for practice. At first, with his framed diploma on the wall and his well-bred southern manner, he had attracted an enviable clientele, the gentry of Dallas. But word of his condition slowly made the rounds. talk spread and the higher class of trade steadily dwindled off. Few people were willing to be treated by a dentist afflicted with what was commonly termed galloping consumption. His cough had worsened over the last month, and he was often unable to hide the bloody refuse spat into his handkerchief. Though he was drinking more, sometimes a quart a day, the bourbon brought only temporary relief. His cough was constant, from the time he awoke until he drank himself to sleep. Strangely enough, he felt energetic and otherwise healthy, which he attributed to the drier climate. He had discovered as well that he had an astonishing tolerance for alcohol. No matter how much he drank, he never became drunk, and the whiskey seemed to fuel his stamina. For all that, his dental practice had dropped off sharply, limited now to walk-in trade, teamsters and laborers, the rougher crowd. Some days he had only two or three patients, and some days none at all. His fees scarcely covered the rent. In the quiet of the office, dwelling on it, he decided he'd had enough for one day. Even though it was still early afternoon, he quickly washed his instruments and laid them out to dry. Then, gathering his hat, he moved through the door, locking it behind him. He walked toward the hotel. Seated at the desk in his room, Holliday stared at the blank sheet of paper. Maddie's response to his first letter had arrived last week, and he'd put off answering day by day. But now, knocking back a shot of whiskey, he labored to find the right words, subtle, yet not painful. He dipped a pen in the inkwell.
"My dearest Maddie, yours of May 20 arrived in good order, and most welcome it was, too. Not a day goes by but that I think of you and wish myself back in Atlanta. Texas, for all one hears, lacks greatly in social amenities, hardly the place people of our background would choose. I nonetheless concede that the dental trade here is brisk. One prospers at the expense of Texans who value many things above a full set of teeth. Only today I extracted a tooth from an affluent gentleman of modest age and exceptionally disturbing dental habits. Like many here, he will soon have a set of the false variety. A DDS could scarcely fail to succeed in this frontier outpost. Be that as it may, I cannot report that the climate here is as beneficial as Tom Eckhart suggested. My condition has improved to no noticeable extent, and I am still plagued by bouts of coughing. Not that I offer this as a complaint, but merely as an observation. The affliction I live with, as you know, recognizes no healer apart from time. Even so, there are no covenants that warrant cure. Still, one hopes. I do most heartily regard the encouragement and kind wishes so lovingly expressed in your letter. Should ever a man seek salvation, he would utter your name, and I do so with regularity. Yet I dread the thought of you waiting there, too patient and too faithful, with no life of your own. I most sincerely urge you to avail yourself of the social activities always present there, and not deny yourself by my absence. To know that you heed my wishes in this respect would bring me inordinate pleasure and great happiness. For you surely know that the certainty of happiness for me is to be found in your joy, your fulfillment in life. I remain, as ever, most fondly yours, John."
Holliday stared down at the words. He wondered if she would read between the lines, see the message penned there. To say it more openly was beyond him, for he could not bear to inflict pain on her. He had to hope that she would forgo hope and forget. In that moment, he realized that he had never felt more lonesome or alone. He was a stranger in a strange land, and he damned the illness that had brought him there. He damned life. Quickly, before he could change his mind, he sealed the envelope. Holliday awoke with bright sunlight streaming through the window. He sat up on the edge of the bed and took his pocket watch from the nightstand. After an all-night poker game, he'd got to sleep around 5 in the morning, and it was now going on noon. He yawned, arms curled in a wide stretch. A sudden spasm erupted deep in his lungs. He reached for a bottle on the nightstand, popped the cork, and took a long pull. The whiskey was raw, molten fire, searing him from gullet to stomach. But on the way down, it stopped the coughing fit, and he tossed off a second dose for good measure. He was ready to face the day. The room was stuffy with the forenoon heat of early July. He moved to the washstand, sloshing water from a pitcher into a wide oval basin. The image he saw in the mirror was a ghost of his former self, his features gaunt and pallid. Still, for a man whose closest companion was death, he wryly thought there were mornings he'd looked worse. He began stropping his razor. For the most part, musing on it as he shaved, he thought the sporting life agreed with him. Toward the middle of June, when the coughing fits finally robbed him of patience, he had closed his dental practice. By then, he was spending more time in the gaming dives than fixing teeth, and it seemed logical to transform a pastime into a new vocation. All the more so, since he needed a steady source of income simply to cover routine living expenses. Virtually overnight, he became a professional gambler. Oddly enough, he found that the regimen of a gambler agreed with him. Sometimes, as happened last night, he might play from late afternoon until the early morning. But these marathon sessions of 10 or 12 hours rarely sapped his spirits. If anything, good cards, mixed with liberal doses of whiskey, seemed to restore his vigor. His lungs protested the strain, and some days he coughed with every other breath. Yet he not only survived, he thrived. All in a short time, he had earned a reputation among the sporting crowd. He won more often than he lost, particularly when the stakes were high, which was the mark of a professional. The larger contest was with rough, brawling men who thought his affliction made him an invalid, and therefore easily intimidated. He was quick to call their bluff and let it be known that he subscribed to a deadlier credo. He operated on the premise that God made men, but Samuel Colt had made them equal. So far, no one had pushed it to the limit. To underscore his point, Holliday went dressed for trouble. On his hip, he now wore a Colt Peacemaker, chambered for .45 caliber, with a 4 3/4-inch barrel. The finish was lustrous indigo blue, and the grips were custom-made of yellowed ivory. Beneath his suit jacket, in a spring-loaded shoulder holster, he carried a Colt Lightning, chambered for .41 caliber, with a 3.5-inch barrel and a bird's head butt. The Lightning was officially scheduled for release by Colt in January, but his gunsmith had managed to obtain an early production model. The pistol was double action, which eliminated having to cock the hammer for the first shot. A simple squeeze of the trigger got the job done. Apart from hardware, Holliday had ordered a new wardrobe as well. Gamblers customarily wore dark suits, with white shirts and dark ties, which gave them the look of prosperous undertakers. To celebrate his new profession, Holliday chose a more distinctive look, with tailored suits in a variety of colors. His wardrobe now included light gray, muted blue, and pale beige, and a selection of pastel shirts matched to complement the suits. The overall appearance was one of sartorial elegance, a spiffy dresser. He stood out from the rest of the sporting crowd. Today, when he came downstairs, he was attired in a vested suit of gray with a dove-colored shirt and a royal blue tie. His one concession to local custom was a wide-brimmed Western hat with a domed crown. In the lobby, the desk clerk greeted him with a letter from the Morning Post. He glanced at the envelope, recognizing the perfectly ovaled script, and stuffed it into his pocket. Outside, the blast of summer heat brought an instant film of perspiration to his face. He crossed the busy intersection to the Bon Ton Café. Bertha brought his usual breakfast of soft-boiled eggs, dry toast, and coffee. He laced the coffee with a shot from his flask, then read the letter while he ate. His appetite, never strong in the best of circumstances, was further spoiled by what he read. Mattie continued to ignore, or even acknowledge, his many hints, that she should make a life for herself in Atlanta. She seemed determined in her belief that God, in some magical way, would cure his consumption and they would once more be together. The last paragraph stopped him cold.
The Lord in his infinite mercy will guide us through our moment of travail. We have only to trust in him and never allow our faith to waver. I know, just as you do, John, that the Lord meant...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.